voor de crisis, of wat je bedoelt in dat idee van boundaries, sowohl voor de bevolking, space en dan boundaries, by space en you who, how, what is the buildings work from inside out, what is the program of space, and how can we make it most suitable for the user. And then the last one being daylight. And daylight is maybe a bit too much of an overall headline, but daylight, how can light give atmosphere to space, and how can light work and also give materials and crafts inside the buildings. So I think generally for this it's not a style of stuff, it's maybe more a theme, and maybe more one thing that goes against is the social space, where people interact and where people meet despite the technology, despite the funding of right. So I'll show you some of our Scandinavian projects. This is a IT university in Copenhagen, just in Denmark. The plan is quite simple. Two rectangulars, with a walk, facade, a public access between the buildings, with the main volumes. So two main volumes, between these two you have a public access in the area. And inside this building, this is where you have all these meeting rooms or workspaces that sticks out. On the ground floor, we have all the toilet, the canteen, all the shared spaces for all the students. And as you get a little break from having more focus than we are. Go out there and get a break with the nature before you go on to the next section of the piece. Next to this, in the same part, the same complex, but so this is like a brother and sister or a little family of buildings. So in the, this is the School of Architecture. It's kind of an inversion of the layout of the museum. So in all the public spaces or shared spaces in the center, it's a parameter for the location of the museum. Here, a parameter is then where all the students sit. So all the students get a good view out to the landscape. They also get the best daylight coming in. We have no screening, we have no smart here. So there's not the same amount of daylight coming in, so you want to be at the parameter and get the view up. Okay. In the center, then we're clustered together all the meeting rooms and the workshop places. The actual building is actually one big space. There's no, the students who sit in the different floors at the parameter, there's no doors into the studios. And that's the difference, that when you're moving around the building, when you're moving as a student, you're always passing somebody's desk and you can just have a look, you can comment on a sketch or have an informal conversation. There's no closed door as such. You need to have a closed room or a closed door to go into the sensor. So there's kind of, it's an open environment. So two of our education for the extended, I was going to talk a little bit about context. This is a project that we finished a year and a half ago at the HAPA conference hall of Iceland, right? Iceland, I don't know if you've ever visited Iceland. Iceland is a quite fantastic nature experience. If you go, I mean, you have 90% of the view is sky. It's a volcanic island. You go out on the glacier, the grass is dressed in green, the soil is black from the volcano. I mean, it's, you have a strong connection to the sea. And if you are, when you're with Atlantic people, they always talk about the weather and our nature, and let's go up on the mountain climb. So nature is a very strong, very important part of life. The project, the actual concert hall, we were building for the artisanal sports for a site, right on the edge of the industrial harbor. So it's quite a big change for the city. It was an industrial harbor. There was no people who wouldn't go on the harbor. It was cold and winter, and there was nothing to come for at the harbor. It was fishing boats or people there, industrial area. So, oops. So the idea, the reason that we were, we had the concert hall in South Hill, but then there was actually plans for a larger, like a historical city in here, or the existing city here, and then to connect, like enhance the journey out towards the harbor. But for sure that the concert hall would be this urban catalyst, say, for the food. The building itself is quite, in plan you can say, straightforward. There's three halls. The main concert hall, the multi-purpose hall, and then the conference hall, which is a flat floor that could be used for and then these three boxes, flat concrete, very solid, very solid wall boxes, is then wrapped in this based facade structure, and between this straight rectangular boxes and the more formal sculpture, that structure, then you have all the social space and the breakout spaces. Now, back to content, back to the nature of Einstein. I mean, Einstein has, in summary, the sun hardly goes down, in winter, the sun hardly shows up. So light is one super important element that works into the night. And the other part is the, as I talked about before, the volcanic stone. And the volcanic stone has these, there's these fantastic volcanic formations that is left after which we used as inspiration bringing that into the facade system. The facade system which we developed together with an aesthetic artist, and together we developed this quasi bricks. These are like full-scale, scale steel structures. They are fixed together. It's a structural system. And then inside these blocks, you have a special film glass that reflects the light differently. So on the main. So there's both a three-dimensional quantitative structure on one side and a two-dimensional it's wrapped in this lace skin. And I think this is an essential illustration of the project. We wanted to keep this connection to the outside, the connection to the surrounding nature. So this transparency that we have in the breakout space is still apparent when you're inside. And then of course when this place wrapped in the skin is depending on the day, depending on the season, on the weather, constantly having changes. And you come and also attract, I mean all of a sudden this thing is really central of also how cultural buildings can become urban catalysts, what they create around them. For sure there was nothing in the harbor before this, and all of a sudden now there's a lot of events around the places, and people use it as a public plaza, they go there for destination. So it's certainly the acts that they can hold. This is to talk a little bit about materiality. It's an old project of the office, of our office. It's a new cast that you can see. This is an old historical museum, and it holds a lot of sculptures, and very classical, museum. You have the main testing rooms out here. You have the big atrium with the palm room in here. And then we were asked to work with one of the courtyards, an extension of one of the courtyards. The extension all the way to the roof. And this particular museum has a quite fantastic roof space with little domes and little sculptures that are supporting the floor. So it's a little journey in a quarter, trying to maintain the sense of the historical and old, together with quite new classical music. Right, and then I'll just quickly, this is our project that we've been doing here recently. We were working in Bachelorship, this is close to the study there, Bessemer. It's a the kind of bio-systems development they're doing biomedical pop. They have a huge site, 200 hectares of land, where there's going to be a children's hospital, R&D members, education facilities, but also a lot of housing and a lot of office buildings around. We're not doing all of this, and we're not doing all of this. We're working on one of the plots of the residential area. It is an absolutely amazing site. This is looking downhill, vertical, corridor, you can see 30% slope, so it's a very difficult site. For some to me, we have the old wall, When we started the project, we didn't have so much context. We had there was two sites that had already been drawn up, or the projects that had drawn up. We knew that something that was going to happen in the downtown area here, but it hadn't been really massive plans, so we weren't quite sure what we were going towards. But we kind of figured between these two existing, well, not existing, but already drawn projects, that there was like a main structure, some stairs going down, and probably would be a corridor leading down into something that was more than downstairs. So this was our context, together with the nature of the building. We also knew that there was a children's hospital that we could have here, and there was a sports area for those residential community here. And then maybe it's probably going to be some plaza, some connecting down. There was quite amazing, the land, the nature of the land is magnificent. So horizontally, we wanted to bring the green into the site as much as we could, bring the soft landscape into the area. This is a project in its current state. So this is the corridor that runs straight through the development, through the connecting the whole of the residential part of the area on the hillside. And a horizontal route that connects all the different units, because people are probably not going to go up and down so much, but we need to connect them in a horizontal connection. We had a lot of conversation about why would people move out there? What would they do out there? And we do it ourselves. I think this was kind of this is what we put out of it. We will probably move out of it. We want to have a house, we want to be close to the green, but we also want some urban cafes or connection with our neighbors on the other side. So this was our existing area, this is what was developed around. So we tried as much as we could to limit the footprint on our plot of land. We had on one side, we had a green buffer, so you had to felt still you had the connection to nature. And then we had to bring a big park through the area. has to, I think everything above 75,000 square meters has to be treated as a master plan. You cannot call this single buildings at that scale. And so we were trying to break that, and I think this is kind of a community conference zone in a way that we call it. So from the single units where you have your apartments and developing the private space to something to the atrium or to the courtyard, so it's today, maybe 100 people in a shared space, to something that is more neighborhood, this corner where there's a community group, all the way up to some to more classes spread. So working with these clusters, it's the same units, just twisted around. But moving from the scales of courtyards to something that's city, public, private, to something that's a lot more public this year for the larger. And I wanted to show this because we were quite fascinated by the whole EMSA we've done these EMSA drawings now, and I think it's quite amazing how sometimes things are window or design. But I don't think it's only in Turkey. I think this is something that's happening in many cities around the world, in many, what is it, rapid growing cities around the world. This is something that's, I'm working on a chapter for a book about urban design while we're doing this project. And this is not about design, this is about the process of design. It's not about how it looks, it's about how master planning, how you deal with the processes, taking the ideology of the mature city and the way the process are there compared to the new city. Examples of that I mean, where the mature cities, the slow growing city where you have the new stuff that's very much aging. In the new cities, it's very much developer who maybe is more in the aging of the projects. The agenda, from maybe being more citizen oriented, it becomes more investor driven. Where it used to be the municipality who were very involved, it's more about marketing and sale. And these processes maybe that you had in the mature cities, the urban planning there becomes more products, which is made by getting a lot of bird's eye view and icons to look at more than actually being down at eye level and looking at the master planning. And I think it's so easy with all these buzzwords that we go again and again when we talk about urban planning, but actually maybe where we should be looking is in the process, how they look, but how what's the difference between, for example, collaboration and negotiation? Collaboration between clients and consultants or parties around the table. How can you start with a shared vision there before you start with your 3D vendors and do a quick fix or something? So a shared vision is not something that's written down or discussed or communicated, but not vision. So you start with the same house. Anyway, I don't have an answer to this, or I think it's just a quote. Then very quickly, the last one, and I've got to say, because we just got the pictures, it's a building we haven't, it's not open yet, it's not finished, but I just wanted to share with you. It's a museum for anthropology, the biggest anthropological collection of Denmark. We have some physics and existing facilities, and they needed, they got a piece of land to expand on. They had the hillside here, and we found this is the competition entry that we want. And we found out when we went to the site, well, when we get up here, we best have a look, or enough, high enough, to get up and have a look over the bay. This is a built project, you know, so you arrive back here where the old parking structures here, trees and whatever fields. You arrive and maybe you can use the whole surface of the museum as a public picnic place, as a destination. It's a little bit out of town, so it would probably, it's good to have an attraction on the map and a visiting museum. You can use what is actually a private building, it might have some funding from the public, but it is a private museum, but it's very open to the public. Because I think it's also interesting here where a lot of the contemporary museums here are actually private. So it's also interesting when private entities become public. The idea, you have the slight slope, you're digging platforms into it, like you do with a lot of things, and then you have this big roof that's following the slope. Close to the roof.
encountered since you have first appeared into the Turkish architectural production stage?
Production stage or
the architectural scheme of Turkey.
As an
architectural office, what were the main obstacles, what were the main problems in a way that you first encountered in Turkey?
There's not many foreigners here who actually are working here. And I think we really have the philosophy that we're doing project in a place, we would like to be there. Put our hands on the ground, figure out how does it work. Personally, I'm not a big fan of designing and planning out architecture. Let's do a quick concept design and get somebody else to do it. We kind of like we follow things to the end and work in the design phases in the beginning, very close to the client, to get back to the user. What is it that these guys are here, and what is it they want? What do they want for this museum? What do they want for this school? What is it about? Understand that. And then understand what's the wanted for something, what level of quality will they go to this thing, and how can we the best way get something out there. And I think that's super hard. It's super hard to have dialogue with we're finding people who like to have this dialogue around ambitions and want to say that's the most important thing, great. So we work with this. But when it becomes identity and skills only, then it becomes very hard to find, because it's the same lifestyle, everyone, the same things again. We need to find an edge for people, and I think that's, that has been hard for us to do that, we are a mix of Turkish and Scandinavian architects in the office, so I wouldn't say we all speak Turkish, but we feel it. Looking at studying, and I think it is.